nearby.
And welcome on our sunrise safari, a live safari beamed straight into your living rooms or wherever you happen to be from the middle of the African bush. Now, we are coming to you live from Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains game reserves in the Sabi Sand in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa, and obviously starting off with what is personally my favorite herd of elephants. My name is Jamie and I will be out with you on the vehicle along with Brent and... and what's his name again? I can't remember his name. Zander. Zander. I do know Zander. I'm sorry. But what I wanted to say, actually, where I was going with that was Brian is back. Brian is back on board with us once again. And of course, when Brian comes back to work, so does the thumb. So I think you'll all extend a warm welcome back on board the vehicle to Brian. It's wonderful to have you back. And we are also interactive, which means send through your questions on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And let us go back to our wonderful animals. I said this is particularly my favorite group of elephants. The lovely mixture of, oh my goodness, that calf's actually got so big. A little one. We've been watching this calf since it was only a few weeks old. And this lovely herd of elephant, it is the short-trunked elephant herd. She's got an older female, a male, and this little calf. What are you doing? Oh, goodness. Life's tough when you can't really use your trunk too well. I'm going to spend... oh, what's wrong? What's up, guys? It's awesome. Coming right round to the front of the vehicle. This particular family of elephants has always been incredibly relaxed around the vehicle. And what's been really nice to watch is because this particular elephant cow doesn't have a herd, she's created her own. Hello. Hello. Oh, you're very big and scary. Hi. Hi. And now? Now what? You are so brave. You are so brave. Hey, little one. There you go. Look, female, that is not the mom. It's either the mom's oldest daughter or it's her younger sister coming to make sure that the little one behaves itself. And that was really nice behavior to see from a female calf. They don't often do that. Coming up to say hello to the vehicle. All the learning that is happening in a little elephant's life is very, very important. And these first few months are absolutely crucial. Brian, everybody is as thrilled to have you back on board with our safaris as I am. So lots and lots of welcome backs to Brian.
Thank you, everyone. I'm so happy to be back.
Yeah, what a nice way to start our morning, isn't it? I have to find Brian some special things to look at today. Are you coming back? Are you coming back? Are you brave? So brave. No, just want that piece of grass. It's actually really lovely to be out in the bush at the moment because after that rain, things are starting to turn green. Hello. What are you doing with your trunk? Hello. Little girl, you're being so brave. You've never done this before. What you doing? What you doing? Oh, so brave. So I often think that baby elephants actually enjoy what you're doing. Often enjoy having us around because we provide a distraction and something for them to do because they get bored. They can't eat all the time. They don't need to eat all the time because they've still got mom's milk. A human being in a vehicle provides an entertaining form of distraction when all the adults are busy being boring and eating the trees. Yes, very brave. I was very scared there, just so you know. Were you scared, Brian?
I was terrified.
Terrified. That's very scary. Met with the complete tolerance, sort of a wise indifference from the adults. That is so very special. And what I love about this particular herd is, first of all, as I said, this isn't the mom of this particular calf, but she takes so much responsibility for this little one, as does the little male that is with this group as well, and is obviously the older brother to our little female. And he also, I've noticed him caring for this calf in a way that's very female. Generally, it's the females in a herd that dedicate themselves to looking after this calf, but in this special, unique little family, the dynamics are all topsy-turvy, and the male looks after the little one just as much as either his older sister or his aunt. And the lovely thing about them is they are so relaxed around the vehicles. And a very warm welcome to Richard in British Columbia while we watch our little baby elephant. Richard, absolutely. I think that learning to use a trunk is, I'm not sure if I would call it as hard as learning to write, but when you think of what a trunk can do, so basically Richard's saying, is it as hard for them to learn to use their trunk as it is for us to learn to write? I would compare it to fine motor coordination in a toddler. So being able to catch and throw, grab, close a fist, pick something up and coordinate that sort of thing. And a trunk is a very, very delicate instrument. It's capable, not just yet, not this little one, but it is capable of pulling down the largest branch of a marula tree, and yet at the same time delicate enough and gentle enough to pick up something the size of a toothpick or a matchstick off the ground. Now, it is a complex process, and watching a baby elephant learn to use its trunk is probably one of my favorite things in the world. And you watch them. I mean, this little one, she must be about 8 months old now. I think that's about roughly when we started seeing her for the first time, and she was very, very tiny. Just watching baby elephants with their coordination. Hello, big girl. That's my favorite girl. Hello, beautiful. I love this elephant. I've got such a soft spot for her. We see her all the time. She's missing a third of her trunk. Probably, we'll never know exactly what happened, but most likely due to picking up a wire snare or getting caught in a wire snare. And I think that's probably the reason why she's lost out on having a herd. Well, she's created her own little herd now, but I think that's why she became separated from the rest of her family, whatever her history may have been. And that wouldn't have happened here in the Sabi Sand, but remember that we are open to the world-famous Kruger National Park and several other reserves, where these animals can trundle through unimpeded by fences. And whilst that is a magical thing, sometimes it does put them more at risk in certain areas than others. And whilst it is very sad to see, at the same time, looking at that particular injury doesn't even make me sad anymore, because she's learned to work around it completely. She's perfectly healthy. She's got her own beautiful family. And nature carries on. I'm going to go forward just a little bit to try and get us a slightly different view. And while we do, going back to our trunk learning conversation, Kathy in Tennessee wants to know what age a little elephant will be when it is proficient with its trunk. Ooh, sorry. Kathy, probably around, you start to see them being a lot more effective at around just over a year, and then a year and a half too. But even right up until 3 years old, you'll still watch. If you watch them really closely, you'll see them making mistakes. So it's something that they practice and that they work on, obviously, all the time, because they need that trunk in order to survive. What amazes me, what I would love to know, I'd love to be able to know this elephant's backstory. I'd like to know what life was like for her learning to use her trunk as is, because she won't have been born that way. And if you watch her, she does a lot more of this process. Instead of twisting and breaking it off with her trunk, because obviously she doesn't have that tip, she still uses it, but she basically uses it in a much rougher manner. She pulls the branches into her mouth and then bites directly off the tree. There's another elephant, a male, that has a much shorter trunk. And he really struggles to feed. She's gorgeous. Okay, we're going to stick with our elephants for a little bit longer until they disappear off into the dense vegetation. In the meantime, poor Brent hasn't even had a chance to say good morning, so let's head on to the back of Rusty.
Well, a wonderful, large good morning from the middle of the African bush. And you see, I've got my tea. And it's always good to track in the early winter's mornings with a cup of tea. Helps get the brain matter flowing. So I'm busy looking for Queen Karula and Hosana and Shongile. They were just up in here a bit earlier, or last night. And I've got tracks now. Some upset elephants behind me somewhere. I can only see a track. This looks like one of the cubs, which means that Karula's tracks must be around here somewhere. So they are heading west. We are quite close to our southern boundary, so fingers crossed. Ah, there we go. There's Karula. So heading, if they go in a straight line from here, they're probably going to come out around Treehouse Waterhole. So I'm going to get hold of Herbie on the radio. And I think we're going to work that area quite extensively. So there's always a possibility, which I thought, that she might leave the cubs there and go off hunting. But it looks like she has taken the cubs with her, which is fine. We just don't want her to go south. If she goes west or north or even east, it's okay. And of course, those who were watching the sunset safari last night will know that Tingana left us and he went further to the east. Ooh. Yeah, let's get back into the car, get hold of Herb, and figure out where the Queen and her cubs have gone. Of course, as I said, we're alive in the African bush, and we are tracking leopards. But while we track leopards, Jamie's got that incredible short trunk herd of elephants.
We do indeed, and this will probably be our last view of them, because unfortunately they are disappearing off into some very, very dense strychnos, or monkey orange. We get them in these dense thickets around Juma. So we're at the moment slowly losing our view. And they spent the entire night around the house that we live in. We spoke a lot recently, particularly with the drought, about the various adaptions that animals can demonstrate when they're attempting to supplement their diet in order to survive the drought. We spoke a lot about it in terms of the dacre and the warthog and the fact that they will eat meat, they will scavenge off carcasses, and they will even eat things like small birds if they can catch them. But Aaron wants to know if elephants will ever eat meat to supplement their diet. And the answer, Aaron, I've never seen it. They will chew bones. I have seen an elephant chew a bone before. But I've never seen them or heard of them chewing on meat. However, that being said, just because I haven't seen it or heard about it doesn't mean that it doesn't happen. Now, it makes sense to me that they might try and supplement the protein intake that they have in their diet every now and again. However, there is a certain way that elephants respond to carcasses that makes me wonder exactly how they would react or how they would go about that. Because elephants they have a natural curiosity, and something that a lot of people interpret as mourning, particularly around elephant carcasses. They seem to gather around and they play with the bones. Playing is the wrong word, perhaps. They fiddle with the bones, pick them up, turn them over, touch them with their trunks. And I've seen them avoid carcasses. I've seen them walk around carcasses rather than go up to them, even when there's no predators in sight. I must say, it would be an interesting experience to get to see an elephant going forward to eat meat. I've never seen it, but as I said, life out here is very unpredictable. Oh, I'm watching baby elephants walk. So it's not impossible that they would eat meat. But I think it would be a very hungry elephant indeed. that would overcome that natural distaste that they seem to have for carcasses. And Michael, welcome back as always to our Sunrise Safari. Yes, little baby elephants will suck on their trunks as a comfort mechanism, just like human beings suck on their thumbs. It's one of my favorite things to witness, when they curl their trunk up into their mouths and just suck on it gently, or else reach forward and grab the adult's tail, both of which serve a very comforting, a comforting purpose in a way to a little baby elephant. So they do, they suck their trunks like people suck their thumbs. The wonderful thing about baby elephants is I think we can relate to them. Those of you with children or grandchildren or friends with children, there's so many behavioral little idiosyncrasies that baby elephants develop that are so similar to toddlers. They have tantrums sometimes. In fact, while you were with Brent, we just witnessed a little bit of a tantrum. They have tantrums when they can't get what they want. They tell on each other, which we've definitely seen before on our live safaris. They definitely snitch. We saw it with a group of three baby elephants, two older and one younger. And the older one stole something from the baby elephant. The baby elephant let off this earth-shattering scream like it had been grievously injured. Mom came sprinting out of the bushes, and immediately she looked at us to see if we were provoking her little one. Then she looked at the two older elephant calves and immediately singled out the one that had been responsible for the transgression and went and disciplined him. So that was communicated somehow. She wasn't anywhere near the area. She can't have known that. There's so much going on in an elephant's life that we have no idea about, which to me is what makes them so special and so enjoyable to spend time with. Although, unfortunately, I would say our sighting at this point is pretty much over. They have ducked into some dense vegetation, and until this drought breaks and things change, we won't be trying to go off-road to get better views of elephants. We will leave that be and reduce our impact as much as we can. Very peaceful way to start off a Wednesday morning. Franklin's calling, Hornbill's calling. So my plan is, while Brent is busy with Herbert tracking down Karulas, to go and find the Nkuhumas, because I feel as though they have disappeared somewhere and they can't have gone that far. None of us have found tracks going out. I wasn't out on safari the whole of yesterday because I went into town, which always makes one feel a little bit behind, like you don't know where anything is, or you've lost track of where everything is. But from what I understand from the other guides, nobody's seen hide nor hair of the Nkuhumas, and I would like to find the Nkuhumas for Brian so that he can see how big their cubs have got. There's 8 now, Brian. Yep, there's another set we didn't know about. Forgot to tell you that. It was quite a surprise. That is what I think we shall do. We shall go look for our lion pride. Oh, well, we go and track down our big lions. Let's go back over to Brent, find out how his leopard search is going.
Okay, so we're on the southern boundary. Unfortunately, I've got tracks here. I'm just trying to figure out exactly where they go. The last track was just around here next to the vehicle, a little bit down of Karula and both the cubs. Unfortunately, it does look like they've gone south across our boundary. They crossed just here. But what often happens is she might meander and zigzag back into our property. So what I'm going to do, I'm causing traffic jams. What I'm going to do is jump back in the car, check a little bit further to the south. If we have no luck, then shoot on. Shoot east to Cheetah Plains. I apologize for going back here. I just want to check one last spot and have a chat to, looks like Rodney. I can't see in the sunlight from Cheetwa. Karula Mampimpan. Sorry about this, guys. Morning meetings, you know. One must tell everyone else what's going on. Right next to you there. It looks like Krula and both Mampimpan have crossed. Yeah, yeah. Karula. Yeah. Oh, here's... But they're Dala, they're going up and down. But I can't find any truck further up, so I think they must go on this way, because there's nothing coming in. They just finished Amala and then caught in an hour.
This
side? Yeah. Okay, I'm going to keep checking this side.
Okay.
Good luck, guys.
Thank you.
Oh, dear, Karula. Why do you want to go south? So much nicer in the north. Anyway, we're going to keep checking a little bit further up the road. Hopefully she meanders back towards us. If she doesn't, then I think we'll go to Cheetah Plains. I keep trying to get there and never quite make it. Oh, here we go. Remember, if you want to know why I'm wandering around in the bush on foot, send me a question to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. So what I am doing is tracking a leopard who's got two cubs. I'm just going to move off the road for a second. Let the other vehicle go past. They move a bit quicker than I do. And hopefully we'll check up just a little bit further up to Weaver's Nest. Check up to Weaver's Nest Road if we have no luck there. Oh, and there's another car coming. We'll just wait here for a second. Busy highway in the morning. When I consider the road busy, it means I see more than two cars in a game drive.
Another one.
Oh, there's another. Oh, my goodness. Oh, no, that's Herbie. I'm just going to ask Herbie to double check there quickly. And there's Herbie. Say morning, Herb.
Good morning.
If you stop here, just look a little bit there.
Yeah,
I think it goes south, but the Mampimpan Lala, so it's going across. Yeah. So she might still come back outside. I'm going to check up to Weaver's Nest. If I get Lutu, I'm going to find my Cheetah Plans.
Okay. I will double check here to see.
Yeah. But just check right here. There's Nkonzo of both one side and the Mampimpan Lala. But I think they're going south.
Yeah. I will double check.
Thanks very much, Herb. Hi, Michael. A very good morning to you, Michael. Michael's wondering if there's any update on Tundi and her cubs and Shadow and her cubs. Sorry, Michael, I thought I saw a track. Shadow, I'm not sure. No one's seen her for quite a while. But she could be in those monkey orange thickets on Hoffman's. And then Tundi, yes. Tundi might have moved her cubs. That's all I've heard. So she's moved them away from the lodge. So fingers crossed she moved them towards Cheetah Plains. I'm going to go have a look down that side if we get no luck up here. Unfortunately, it isn't looking positive in terms of career tracking. But we know the Queen, and the Queen is allowed to change her mind at any time. So there's a strong possibility she could have looped in, looped out. She might just be leaving the cubs around. She's got a couple of favorite areas in this little drainage line down here to leave the cubs. And so far, no, we've got no tracks here. So I think let's move to Cheetah Plains, and while we head east towards the rising sun, let's go see how Jamie's morning is going.
While Brent heads to the east, we are going south to check around Treehouse Dam and figure out what's been around, basically. I can re-familiarize myself with the movements of the various animals and figure out where everything is and just show Brian how much has changed since he left on leave just over 2 weeks ago. It's definitely greener. It is definitely greener. It's so nice to see the green shoots coming through. Everywhere I look, I see a little fresh patch of green. And it does. Brian's right. He put his finger on it. It feels damp this morning. It's sort of... it must be the dew point, but it does feel incredibly soggy out here, which is an absolute pleasure, because over the last few weeks we've just had, it's been cold, but it's just been totally dry. Now to go out with a little bit of moisture in the air is an absolute pleasure. Now I'm checking Treehouse Dam for a couple of reasons. One, Tingana was around yesterday, and he likes to walk this path from wherever he happens to be. It's his regular route through Juma. And two, Karula likes to walk this path, and three, it's where the lions like to walk. So Treehouse Dam is a veritable treasure trove of different animals, or at least their tracks. That's sort of what I'm hoping anyway. At the moment though, everything is hiding away. But I think that we should all start to follow Jandre's approach. Jandre's approach is to say, I say Jandre's approach, but with the lion hunt, Jandre had just said, I never see anything on this road. I don't think I've ever seen anything happen on this road. And he was to eat his words at a later stage. And good morning, Gregory. Welcome to the Sunrise Safari. Yes, I did say I'd gone into town, and Gregory wants to know how far away it is and what it is called. So I went into the nearby town of Hoedspruit, which takes us roughly an hour and a half, hour 15, hour and a half to get to. It's a really, really nice drive because most of it is spent driving along the Orpen Road. So Orpen is a gate at Kruger. And you drive all along, and you've got the Timbavati on one side, you've got a whole load of game reserves on one side, and on the other side you see elephants and buffalo. It's such a lovely drive to do. And then you go into the town of Hoedspruit. Hoedspruit is the bustling metropolis of this area. By bustling metropolis, it has two roads and sort of three main centers where you can go shopping. But it has absolutely everything you need. You are guaranteed at one point or another to bump into somebody that you know. Or once you've been living here for a while, you bump into a lot of people you know. Almost always, when you've got some kind of bizarre request from somebody at camp, something that you've gone to go buy for somebody else, and you'll inevitably walk out with an armful of whatever it happens to be. I'm thinking particularly of the incident where I bought about, I don't know, what felt like 50 kilograms of diapers, and was walking out of Pick and Pay and bumped into a whole load of people that I knew who shot me very skeptical looks. Obviously it wasn't for me, but very special place, Hoedspruit. It's become my home. I'm not from Hoedspruit, I'm from Johannesburg. But for me, Hoedspruit is home. And then if you want to go further afield to an actual city, because I'm not entirely sure that Hoedspruit really qualifies as a city, then you can do the 3-hour trip to Nelspruit. I don't like Nelspruit as much. I'm not really a city person as it is. And Hoedspruit has a fantastic history. The name Hoedspruit comes from the original farmer. So what happened in the days when South Africa was in the process of being explored and colonized by the Dutch come Afrikaans people, so the Voortrekkers. They set up an area called Oryxstad, which is not far away from us at all. I'll go into the history in a moment. This was not here when it rained. Very interesting. Or it was, but it wasn't as full. And it just goes to show how much of a natural seep line runs into Treehouse Dam, because this water's come from underground, a lot of it. Some of it came from the rainfall, but a lot of this has soaked through the soil and wound up in Treehouse Dam. This is why we love Treehouse Dam, and why the animals love Treehouse Dam. Because then what happens is the elephants go and dig in the mud next to it and bring up fresh, clean water, as opposed to what's basically now a mud wallow. Now we just need an animal there. Everybody's hiding this morning. But to go back to the history of Hoedspruit, the farmers started up an area called Oryxstad, and what they didn't realize at the time, because as far as I know with the history, they arrived in winter. What they didn't realize was just how bad the malaria and the sleeping sickness was in this particular area. With the invention of DDTs, that has changed completely. But at the time, Oryxstad lost half its population at one point, and they had to move down out of the mountains and towards a place. They started up a city that is now called, well, it's called Mashisheng now, but Leidenburg was its original name. place of tears, tips, because so many people died of malaria in Oryxtat. And then what they did, the community of Oryxtat, which used to extend for miles and miles and miles into the low veld, which is what we call this area, is they basically said to all of their young men, go away, go and start your own farms. And that is what the founder of the Hoedspruit area, I say founder, the original farmer of this area, did. He came through to Hoedspruit, and it's called Hoedspruit because he lost his hat in the river. Hoed, hat in Afrikaans, spruit, river, it's a stream. And in those days, a good hat was hard to find. You couldn't just go down to whatever store you happened to find and buy a new one. And thus, Hoedspruit became Hoedspruit, because the original farmer of this area, I wouldn't say the original occupant, definitely not the case, of course there were people here before, but he lost his hat in the river. And if you ever go and visit Hoedspruit, I am desperately trying to get you a view of the zebra, and they are really not playing ball. Very tricky to see. If you ever find yourself in the lovely little town of Hoedspruit, go to a place called Sleepers, which is a restaurant / bar. Have yourself a jolly good burger, or whatever it is you happen to eat, and have a look at the statue of the big blue hat on a river outside of Sleepers. It's hideous, but it's got a history to it. It really is one of the ugliest statues I've ever seen, but it has a special place in my heart. Zebbies, giving us a really nice demonstration. We'll swing this to a positive. Giving us a really nice demonstration of just how well their stripes break up their outline. Hidden behind the trees. Come on, Zebs. Such beautiful light. And you are so, so photogenic. Feels as though we've had lots and lots of zebra running around at the moment, and waterbuck. Brian, you haven't been around, but I have not done one safari where we haven't stopped at least 3 times for waterbuck. There are so many of them around at the moment. And one woodpecker tapping away solemnly somewhere. I wish I could find it for you, but it's hidden away. Okay, this is definitely not working out for us, this zebra sighting. Let's move on. Go find some lions, or Garula, or Tingana. Who hasn't come this way? Contrary to expectations. Just by the way, said Garula, we're not going to find Garula this morning, or we might, but I'm not just being really pessimistic, but her tracks do cross south into Little Gowrie, is something that I've just heard. So she's, for now, she's crossed out of our traverse area, south of us. What that means, we can't go there, we can't drive there to follow up. However, Garula is nothing if not unpredictable, so who knows if she might decide to pop back over the boundary at some point. And she's probably left her cubs somewhere on Juma. And speaking of Garula, let's go across to the man who was trying to track her down and see how he's doing on his journey across to the far east.
So, unfortunately, Garula and both cubs went to the south. So, I have decided to go to the east, and I'm going to see if we can find the Styx pride of lions. And who knows what else could be on cheetah plains. So, we're arriving at the what that is termed the Cheetah Plains driveway. There we go, you can see the signs up on the left there, Cheetah Plains, and we're going to go down the driveway now. Now, of course, not only do we have Styx lions in this area, we have the possibility at 2 different male leopards, Quarantine and Shivambalan, as well as Ganyin, the female, and Tandi, who's apparently moved to this area. And of course, cheetah. Always a good spot to look for cheetah. We haven't seen cheetah in quite a while. I'd really like to change that this morning. But I know the Styx cubs were around the western boundary of Cheetah Plains yesterday. So fingers crossed we're able to find them this morning. is a glorious winter's morning. Not a cloud in the sky. While we meander towards the heart of Cheetah Plains, let's get your grey matter working. I've got a cheetah question, since we're going to Cheetah Plains, for you guys to answer. Where is the largest meta population of cheetah in the world? Where is the largest meta population of cheetah in the world? I know I've asked it before, but I think there might be some new viewers out there who might be quite interested to know some information like that. So if you know the answer, send through to questions@wildebeests.tv or #SafariLive on Twitter. Now, a meta population is the largest population with the most unique or genetic diversity. So think about it, think hard and carefully. Where's the largest meta population of cheetah in the world? And if you know that answer, as I said, questions@wildebeests.tv on email or #SafariLive on Twitter. Okay. I need to jump on the Game Drive channel, and I'm also about to go through a little gremlin hollow. They live down in this little river system here. So while we duck through the gremlin hollow, let's go see how Jamie's faring.
That particular patch of cheetah plains shall now forever after be called the Gremlin Hollow, just like Philemon's Dip has now been renamed Icicle Dip by Dave, because it's the coldest place on Juma first thing on a winter's morning. Now we're coming up with all kinds of brand new names for the different places that we go. So far, everything is having a bit of a lion this morning. I think we should go to Hyena Road and go find the lions there. Perhaps they never moved that far from that buffalo carcass. Or perhaps they went across to Buffalo's Hook towards those dead elephants, but I don't think so. We lost two elephants in very close proximity to each other in Buffalo's Hook, which is a natural process when the drought hits. As it's, even for winter, actually, as soon as the food starts to get a little bit more scarce, it's harder for the older elephants to eat. Their teeth that are worn down, they can't quite meet their nutritional needs, and age takes its toll far faster in the dry season. So there's two dead elephants on Buffalo's Hook, which is the property to the north of us. And what that has meant, the lions haven't spent as much time as I expected them to there, but what it has meant is that our hyenas haven't paid us a visit in a very, very long time. I believe the bin was outside last night, or one of them at least, was outside last night, and it managed to escape completely unscathed. So that's how you know that our hyenas for now have almost completely deserted us. It's absolutely tragic. I'm so sad. They've gone to the north. I feel a little bit betrayed. Not quite, but I do miss them. I do miss the time that we got to spend at the hyena den. And I'm very disappointed that we never got to watch Gwen's cubs grow up through that stage of being tiny and brown and cute and wobbly to getting their spots and being curious and wandering around, chewing on things and coming up to the vehicle. I'm really sad that we missed out on that particular part of their lives. And that's just purely because I've been spoiled. We've been spoiled with the hyena den action that we've had over the last few months. They've also moved, of course, because, you know, we've got eight lion cubs on Juma that have basically grown up on Juma. And I think the hyenas decided that perhaps messing with a fiercely protective female lion was not their best plan, and they decided it was time to move out of the neighborhood and leave the place to the lions for now. The things will change, the dynamics will shift, and we'll get our hyenas back. I keep telling myself that. That's the mantra I tell myself whenever I go to bed at night. Hyenas will come back. Da. down into the Mulwati drainage. There we go. So Shamsun thinking along similar lines, and also in very similar lines to me. Of course, bad puns are one of my favorite things. So Shamsun's absolutely right. Since all of the animals are having a lion, perhaps we'll find a lion. Bravo, Shamsun. Agreed. Let's go find some lions. Lions having a lion. Standing by. Morning, Herbert. Checked Shabam Treehouse Road and then along to Pangolin Track and now I'm in the Mulwati. Going along Vulture's Nest now. Sorry, guys, just listening to Herbert. Copy that, thanks, Herbert. I'm going to go check Gari Katla and Hyena Road. That was a very detailed description from Herbert as to where he's going and where he's planning on going. He's got his morning all worked out, and we shall be very, very grateful for his assistance. So right now, what Herbert was telling me there on the Game Drive comms was he, to cut a long story short, he's going to check the western edge of Juma to search for any sign of Shadow coming back onto the property. And then those of you who have been keeping tracks of Kheri's maps of Sindile, he's doing circles, isn't he? Oh, not quite. But he's spending a lot of time going through Juma, Bivelzook, Torchwood, background. He was in Arethusa 2 days ago. He's also always on a potential on the cards. The one thing I will say about Sindile, though, you have to track him. You have to go and search for him, because he doesn't come and plonk himself down on the side of the road. Not that many of our leopards do, but you do occasionally bump into Karula or Tingana. With Sindile, we've put in a lot of time and effort trying to follow him and to track him. It took Herbert hours the other week when he had the Impala kill that he was sharing with Mvula to find them. Sindile, by the way, for those of you who are, for whom that was all Greek, I'm talking about leopards. So Shadow is a leopard, Sindile is her oldest son, Shadow also has a younger cub. Sindile has a tracking collar, so that's what I meant when I said that he seems to be going in circles, because every now and again, Kheri Camacho very kindly shares updates with us about where Sindile happens to be. And as I said, he seems to be going in circles. It seems as though Brent has made his way through Gremlin Hollow and out the other side safely and securely with signal still on Rusty. And let's jump on board all the way to the east to Cheetah Plains.
So we've made our way down here. I do not, unfortunately, have the best news. It seems like the sticks have crossed to the north. They found the cubs, but no adult lionesses, so you never know, they might pop up on the hunt. So we're going to keep checking and also maybe have a look for, I know, a firm favorite of all of ours, the quarantine male leopard, and head down towards the open areas, see if there are any cheetah about. But we're going to check three in a row pan first, and then we'll head down to the south to the open areas. So there were lots of different answers to the cheetah meta population. Botswana, Namibia, the Maasai Mara. Those are unfortunately all incorrect. The answer is actually the Greater Kruger. Very, very interesting. The largest. Tiffany. Well done, Tiffany. Tiffany got that spot on. And So, Tiffany, you are correct. It is the Greater Kruger. how it is a massive area, and people always associate cheetah with wide open plains, but they are just as at home in mixed bushveld like this. And the thing is about cheetah is they have such massive home ranges that sometimes it doesn't look like there are as many as them. Oh, someone's already driven there, so we're going to go this way. The road less traveled. I think these are the lion tracks from a bit earlier. This is just the ladies, no cubs. Actually, you know, I've changed my mind. Just have a quick look here. Very interesting. Where are you going, ladies? Where are you off to? Did you go that way? No, these trucks have been driven over. So we are not following them. But I am going to change my thing because it sounds like those lion tracks are heading this way. So they might come back to Cheetah Plains. So I was going to head down towards the south first. I'm now going to head to the north first and just check the northern boundary of Cheetah Plains. And hopefully, and they've left the cubs, they're hunting, and they catch something on Cheetah Plains, and they bring the cubs to us. I can hear that beautiful call. And let's find a gap. That should be a good gap through there. Zander. There we go. It's a red-crested Korhan calling. It is the time of the year where they like to do their mating display. There he is. Hello. Hello, Fluffy. Hopefully if it calls, it might even put up its crest. Oh, there's another one calling. Come on, give us a call. Don't get self-conscious now. Now, Korhan's a part of the Bustid family, the smallest members of the Bustid family. Now, when they do call, they raise the red crest. It is completely invisible until they call. I can't really see if it's a male or female yet. We'll find out if it calls. Oh, it might do the suicide dance. It's a female. Not putting up the crest. But did you see that beak clapping? Oh, where are you off to? Oh, hungry. Why aren't the boys responding? I'm just going to eat instead. Okay, we're quite close to three in a row pan. What are you up to? Picking. But wasn't that incredible to watch that little display with the beak clapping as well as the call? Now what makes me think it's a female, if it had been a male, I'm actually not 100% sure. I'm a bit rusty on sexing of Korhans. Where is my book? can hear others calling. It might call and do that display again. Mostly insectivorous, they will eat fruit as well. And no, I actually think it is a male. It is a male, so when it pops its head up, you can see that gray thing, and underneath that is where the red crest is concealed. So that is a male koran. He's just not showing us his red crest, and he's not doing his suicide dance either. So often nicknamed the suicide bird, they fly right up into the air and close their wings and plummet to the ground, and just before they open their wings, and it's all to impress the ladies. Now, Jamie's got some ladies that impress all of us, so let's go have a look what lady she's got.
Surprise! Hyena Road does it again. Look who we have got here. What have you seen, girl? Oh, where are you going, Mom? Take me with you. Our three oldest in Kahumas, Amber Eyes and their mother. How absolutely lovely. What a fantastic way to start off our morning. I'm holding off repositioning for one moment. I don't think she's going to go too far. Oh, we're so spoiled. These lion cubs are just so incredible, especially in this morning light. Catch her! I'm holding off repositioning for a very good reason, and that is that little one. The third of the oldest set of Nkuhuma cubs. Come on, little one, get up. Come on, Mom's going. We've been a little bit concerned about it. It might be something that will heal up totally. However, the one in Kahuma cub does have a nasty limp and is much more subdued than the rest or than her siblings. I say her, I think it's a she. I haven't had a chance to properly look. Hi, little girl. Come on, little one. Mommy's going. Off you go. No. And I think having to work a lot harder to keep up. The wonderful thing about lions and with lion cubs, I have seen them bounce back from injuries far worse than this little one has. And also, because of the social nature of them, and because of the strength of the maternal instinct, the mother will not leave it behind. She will not go anywhere without it. She'll go back and fetch it and wait for it. For now, though, being guarded by Aunt Amber Eyes, with her very prominent scar on her right shoulder. So she's doesn't have any cubs of her own. She might be pregnant, but it is early stages. She's proved to be a wonderful babysitter for the eight little Nkuhuma cubs. I can't wait till we see them all together. Little one, we suspect we will never know what happened to that cub. It could have been an injury obtained when Mom was hunting, or it could have been an injury when the little cub tried to feed. Oh, stalking! I am the master of the shadows. Yes. Well done. The master of surprise. I love the sounds that they make.
Ow! Ow!
Hi, girl. The tolerant and long-suffering aunt that has to deal with all the baby teeth. Get him! Get him! We've been very spoiled. We have got, for new viewers, we have got 16 lion cubs in the area that we drive. 8 of them belong to the Nkuhumas, and 8 of them belong to the Styx Pride. And as a result, we have had some truly magical sightings over the last few days. Really, truly special. Speaking about the fact that their social bonds are so critical to these cubs' survival, I'm so flat you can't see me. I'm hidden. I'm a patch of grass. And talking a little bit about our injured cubs, Shamsun would like to know if the mother would still carry these cubs if needed. She might, but only in very, very extreme circumstances. So at this point, probably not. They have grown extraordinarily. Hi, little one. Sorry, I'm distracted. Hello. It's okay. It's okay. Come on. Mom's over there. Up you get. As I said, I've seen lion cubs recover from really horrible injuries. I've seen one with a broken leg before that survived thanks to the attentions of the rest of the pride. And whilst Mom never carried it around, it was able to keep pace with the rest of the pride and share their kills, and went on to make a full recovery and have full use of the leg. Come on, little one. The cub's just a little much more subdued than its siblings. And already, from Saturday, when did they finish? They finished off their carcass on Monday. Already they are now, the lionesses are hungry again. They're going to be looking for their next meal. I'm just going to go forward ever so slightly. Yeah, go forward a little bit. Little one. Can I come forward? There you go. I'm just trying to keep an eye on all that's going on. The positioning's a bit awkward for Brian. Just want to see where they decide to move to. Yeah. I think let's go back. We'll go backwards towards Aubrey now that the lioness is lying down. Such a wonderful surprise. Hyena Road is a good choice. Look how cute you are. The lion cub waddle. They really do, they waddle. Begging now for milk, even though at this point they are getting closer and closer to the stage at which Mom will no longer be lactating. Let's go back a little bit, reposition, and while we do, we can answer Tammy's question about, of the 16, how many are likely to survive. It's such a difficult one, Tammy, because it's so dependent on circumstances. So I could tell you that on average, you're looking in this area at around a 60% mortality rate before their first year of life. But your statistics are so skewed, because if a pride takeover has happened, if a coalition takeover has happened, oh, hold on. Sorry, Tammy, I'll get back to you in a second. This is where it becomes very difficult to watch. It's a dislocated hip, I think. It's not putting any weight on that leg at all. Oh, shame, little one. Oh, they're putting a little bit. I'm not sure, but it looks to me like the hip's a bit skew. And there's a very definite size difference between that little cub and the others. We're going to reposition, get a better view, and then we'll go back to answering Tammy's question. But for now, Brent has got one of the canid species.
From a cat to a dog, a side-striped jackal. Not the most relaxed side-striped jackal we've seen. A little bit nervous. There's a pair of them. The other one ran off a bit further. And look at that beautiful eye just keeping a watch on us through the gap in the bush. Oh, no. off it goes. Decided we must be a bit scary. Now, off the jackal goes. I've got some excellent news, everyone. Excellent news. And it's not the fact that we're going to see any of these creatures, or we might, you never know. But there was a lot of debate whether Nkanyeni had lost a cub, and she's only been seen with one cub. This morning she was seen with both cubs, so excellent news. And they were heading south in Kruger, so they might come onto Cheetah Plains either this morning or this afternoon. So I'm going to take a little gamble and head towards that area around the Kruger boundary, and fingers crossed that Nkanyeni is there. And so the sticks have all crossed into Nkoral. The females are hunting, so there's always a possibility they might come back across. But really great news about Nkanyeni. And we have male leopard tracks. Okay. What is going on? Unfortunately, they are right on the boundary. Maybe that's why the jackals were so skittish. Because there'd been a male leopard here not too long ago. Okay, still got. Come on, Mr. Q. Appear on cue. Now, Mr. Q. Oh, there's the jackals again. Now, side-striped jackal tend to alarm call when they've seen a leopard, so it might not be right now. I'm going to have to jump off the vehicle and have a look. Oh, there we go, look at the jackal. Just go forward slightly. A bit more relaxed. Oh, there we go, he's going to come out into the open. A bit more relaxed at this distance. Hello, side stripe. Oh, I find them such incredibly beautiful animals. It's looking for its mate. Well, there we are. We know this is James Richards' favorite, so he's very, very happy. I love that little white tip to the tail. And off the side stripe jugs.
There's two.
Yep. Yeah, so it's found the other member. There we go. Male and female. The pair's reunited. Hopefully they have a den close by, and we might see some little jackal puppies. Since there's so many babies around, I think the jackal should just join in. Okay, I'm going to have to jump off the vehicle, try to figure out where this male leopard is gone. And hopefully we are able to produce both lion and leopard this morning. But speaking of lions, let's go back to Jamie.
For now, we have taken a slightly further position to view these lions. We're just going to play some swapping around of vehicles. Aubrey's going to leave and he's going to make some space for Taxon to come and visit them. So that's why we are where we are at the moment. And so to go back to Tammy's question about the cub mortality rate, so what you can sort of understand what I'm saying in terms of the mathematics of the situation. Because if there's a pride takeover, bye-bye guys, have a lovely drive. Bye. Brian, was she blowing kisses at you there? Too sweet. Some of Aubrey's guests are regular viewers. Let's reposition now that we've got some space and we can answer Tammy's question. So if you look at the statistics, you've got such a high skew in favor of, or not in favor of, in terms of cub mortality, because if a male coalition comes in, they kill all the cubs. That's 100% mortality rate. So it definitely biases the statistic. I would say, as provided the Birmingham boys continue to do what they do best, which is mark their territory, defend their territory, call, keep other male lions away, provided they manage to do that, which I think they shall, because there's four of them, which really does help, then things will be very, very different. They will be absolutely fine. I'm worried about this little cub. Of course we all are. It's a concern that we all have. Hi, little ones. Oh, you're in such a difficult position. I don't want to stress them out at all. We'll just shift forward very slowly. So the answer to the question that Tammy originally asked was, of the 16, how many are going to survive? Roughly how many are going to survive? Hi, can I come here? Do you mind? The little ones. Oh, still into the sun. Hello, baby. I would guess, Tammy, and say to their first year, because after that things change depending on how many males and females we have, probably maybe 14. That's a guess, though. I mean, it's pure speculation. We don't know what's going to happen. Oh, little one. Okay, heads are down. Little cubs are asleep. Or suckling. Anna Marie has asked a question because we've seen them with their fierce predator teeth and their big deep growls that they make. Anna Marie's asked the question, well, she'd love to know when they actually lose their milk teeth and gain their permanent teeth. And Anna Marie, as far as I know, it's just a little bit before 6 months old. Similar to those of you who've had big dogs and puppies. And around 6 months old, they start to develop the permanent set. And of course, it can take up to 2-3 months, that whole process. The first to come through will be the canines, which is really adorable because then they get these little double rows of teeth like little sharks. And the baby teeth don't always fall out straight away. And then they'll start to grow them through. So I would say that, how old are these cubs now? They must be 3 months old. In the next 2 months, we'll start to see signs of permanent teeth. And that, of course, is the joy of these live safaris, is first of all, you get to watch the progress of them growing up. And second of all, we have got the ability, particularly with the cameras that we have got the ability to enhance the view that you are seeing. So look closer, spot things that we might not see with the naked eye. And that will include being able to zoom in on their little teeth. I was watching the highlights from James's drive the other day with the little lion cub yawning. It was adorable, but it also really gave us a lovely view of its teeth. Now, of course, we don't have a lovely view. Oh, we've got a lovely view of the back of her head, which is quite special. But that's about it. It's breakfast time for little ones. Wonder where the rest of the pride are. They must have been here, these incomers have been here the whole time. Ever since they disappeared from that buffalo kill, they've been hiding around in this area, which is what we thought. We just weren't 100% sure. Big stretch from Amber Eyes. She's going to make her way over to her sister or pride mate. And I'm just giving some thought. I'm sitting quietly for a moment because I'm just giving some thought as to how to best explain the answer to Elaine's question, because I know that Elaine's question is one that applies to everybody. Everybody's thinking it, and it's a difficult one. Oh. Okay, Amber Eyes. Fair enough. And our constant cacophony of Egyptian geese every time we come to Hyena Road. The permanent soundtrack of Hyena Road. If roads had soundtracks, Hyena Road would be Egyptian geese. Okay, so Elaine's question is the one that's burning on everybody's minds, which is why, if lions are on the endangered species list, do we not intervene with the cub and its injury? And it is a really good question. It's an entirely salient and an entirely fair question. Lions are not endangered in South Africa. Now, that might seem like a ridiculous statement, but in certain parts of South Africa, the lions are actually overpopulated. Not the case here, because, of course, the natural way of things works it out and nature manages the population on its own. Most of you will know by now, but for new viewers, we have a policy that we only intervene where an injury is human-inflicted. So if, for example, that cub had a snare, like the elephant we were talking about this morning, if that cub had a snare, then we would intervene and we would look after it. But because lions are not endangered in South Africa, and we can't take our excess lions and put them elsewhere, lions are not endangered in South Africa itself. The policy now, the approach that we have taken or adopted, and most conservationists now do, is that wherever you can, you don't interfere. You let nature take its course. And an overpopulation of lions means death to leopards, cheetah, wild dogs. You don't want too many lions in an area. So we don't intervene in this particular instance because it's just the way of things. It's very hard for us to watch. And believe me, I would love to go and scoop up that little cub and take it to the vet right away. Maybe not, though, because I don't think she'd take too well to that. I don't think Mom would take too well. I know Mom wouldn't take too well to that. It's very human of us. We want to go scoop it up and take it and look after it and protect it. We can't, unfortunately. And also, bear in mind, it's very, very expensive. And yes, there's plenty of sources of funds, but could those funds not go somewhere else and do something that is more productive in terms of conservation as a whole? It's difficult, I know. Trust me, everybody wants to try and help and fix something like that, but we can't. There's a level of interference that becomes, our little one, as we're talking about you. Oh, that's not the one with the limp. That one just fell over. I thought it was limping, but it's just fallen over. And who knows what happened to the lion cub? Oh, it was exhausting. Auntie Amber Eyes will take care of you. Although I've seen Auntie Amber Eyes smack a couple of these cubs around quite roughly. But it's wonderful to watch. I mean, little lion cubs are incredibly resilient. And also bear in mind, just on the subject of this cub, not this particular cub, but the injured cub, it's not a death sentence. That cub may well be absolutely fine. I'm still confident it's going to be okay. And if it's not, unfortunately, it's the natural way of things. Cannot have an overpopulation of lions. Nature has its ways of maintaining balance in numbers, and it's a balancing act. And welcome, as always, to Lucy in South Bend, Indiana. Wonderful to have you on board. I'm thinking about where I can reposition without stressing these cubs out to try and make life a little bit easier, although this is a beautiful scene. Lucy would like to know. Sorry, Lucy. Hold on one moment. Go ahead, Tack. You're welcome to join me. Sorry, Lucy. Lucy wants to know if perhaps the mother's hanging back because of the injured cub and whether or not that might be the case. Yes, I think she is. I think she wanted to move further into the river system to hide away. Not from us, just to hide away from the day and find some shade and some protection there. And she walked, and then she stopped and she looked back, and her two cubs came with her and the other one stayed. So yes, I do think that she wanted to leave and that she is hanging back because of the injured cub. Well, that's what lions do for each other, and that's why the chances are that the cub is going to be absolutely fine. Because it's got the protection of the whole pride. On this glorious winter's morning with our lovely little lion cubs, a big welcome to David, who is a new viewer. It is wonderful to have you on board, David, and I'm so glad that we could start off your morning with a lion cub sighting, because they are absolutely just the best thing. They, as Brent describes them, they're delectable. Delectable little monsters. He also described them as fuzzy, because Brent turns into a pile of mush when he is presented with tiny baby cats. David, it's wonderful to have you, and I hope that you will continue watching. You wanted to know where all the male lions are, and that's a very good point. So our standard impression of lions, the one that we are raised with and the idea that Lion King gave us, is that a lion pride consists of a male, or two males, with a group of females. That's actually not the way that lions work. A lion pride is females only and their young offspring, including males, but just their offspring. A pride is a female thing. The males have territories that they defend, and they either on their own or in groups known as coalitions, they have territories that they defend, and within those territories, will be the territories of several different females. So the lions, the male lions rotate between females. They might come and visit, as they did a couple of days ago with the buffalo carcass, although saying visit, I think, is putting it strongly. They came to enjoy the carcass and the free meal that was provided for them. But otherwise, they have a very busy time spent marking their territorial boundaries, keeping other male lions out, and essentially providing a safe haven for their offspring. At the moment, this is the Nkuhuma Pride, and it's my pleasure to introduce you to the Nkuhuma Pride. I said there are 8 cubs. We've only got 3 here at the moment. There are 5 adult females and 8 cubs. And they are dominated for now by a coalition of males called the Birmingham Boys. The Birmingham Boys came in this time last year, took over from a group called the Matimba Males. They killed all of the cubs and several of the Nkuhumas as well in the process because they were young. And a coalition takeover is an aggressive thing for the lions involved. A couple of the Nkuhumas lost their lives to the Birmingham Boys. And now, in the true circle of life, we've got several little Nkuhuma cubs that are Birmingham Boy offspring, or most likely Birmingham Boy offspring. I'm going to try and find us a nice position where we can see the other cubs clearly and we can discuss a little bit more about what's happening with them. For now, let's go to Brent for an update on Cheetah Plains.
So we've thrown a bit of a gamble, and I'm looking for Inkanyeni. I think it might be a little bit early for her to be this far from where they saw her, but you never know. Might as well have a look. So this is the boundary of the Kruger National Park, and she was heading straight south down the road. But there are no tracks here, unfortunately. Have a quick look down there. No sign of leopards. But we'll go check down to the south for some cheetah. Now, hi, Emmy. Welcome to Safari Live, Emmy. Emmy says, this is so cool. I've never seen live streams like this. I can't believe I'm on a safari. Well, believe it, Emmy. And welcome to the middle of the African bush. From wherever you might be sitting, Emmy. And apart from being on safari, you can ask questions. And you can do that the same way you just made that comment. So, Emmy, we would love to hear some questions from you. And again, a big welcome to the Safari Live family. So, I'm definitely think it's worth coming to check down Cheetah Plains on the Sunset Safari. So, Emmy, it's twice a day. In a few hours, we'll do it all again. And you never know what can happen because, as you mentioned, we are live. So, Nkanyin is a female leopard and she's got two cubs. And she was heading towards our northern boundary here, but unfortunately, she hasn't quite made it yet. So, we're going to keep checking down on Cheetah Plains. So all three Styx lionesses and the eight cubs have been found to the north of us. There were two Birmingham boys that went down into Mala Mala, and I know Jamie's just been chatting about them, so maybe they come back up to the north. And we'll find out shortly. Hi, Joey in Australia, who's now 15 in one day. Joey says, can we find some ostrich? They're one of his favorites. Well, Joey, the area we're going into now is probably our best chance at ostriches. That massive open area to the south of Cheetah Plains open area. It's the spot where we've seen ostriches most often. So fingers crossed for you, Joey, that we're going to find an ostrich or two. From the tracks, the Styx lions have literally been everywhere last night before crossing to the north. I've just seen tracks all over the place. Okay. Just checking this patch of woodland that's between the two big open areas. Never know what might be hiding. This is the area where the only pangolin ever on Safari Live was seen. I'm hoping we'll find it again one of these days. Oh, look at that. Okay, we've got one of the not too common trees in this part of the world, a fig tree. It's got a little bunch of birds on top of it. Okay, so right at the top of this tree, we've got a Cape Glossy Starling, but that's not the ones that caught my attention. It's the green ones that are sunning themselves there. That is an African green pigeon basking in the morning light. Oh, here we go, look at those stunning colours. Oh, don't fall over. Oh. A bit of repositioning was needed. So, they are great fruit eaters, and in fig trees, they love the figs, but in this case, I think they're just using it as a convenient basking spot. Now, Zana, just go off to the left slightly. I thought I saw another bird species in there. Is that the starling? Ah, it's... is that? That's the starling. Cape Glossy Starling, and then another Cape Glossy Starling. The colour's changing. Let's go back to the left. Due to the iridescence. So it'll look a different colour. Oh, off it goes, depending on the angle that the light hits it. And the shinier you are as a starling, the more attractive you are. Yeah, well. Let's leave those pigeons to sunning themselves. They're definitely, for me, the most beautiful member of the pigeon family. that we get out here, or pigeon and dove family. And they're sitting in a wonderful fig tree atop a termite mound. But let's keep moving through the woodland towards the vast open plains and see if there's an ostrich for Joey, a cheetah for someone else, and even a male lion for me. A very good morning to Richard in sunny California. Richard is wondering, are lions truly the kings, or are there other predators for lions apart from lions themselves? Well, in terms of the predators out here in the African bush, lions are truly the kings. But the true king of the African bush is probably the elephant. There's not much that messes with a 7-ton big bull elephant. But out of the predators, lions are definitely the kings. Now, other predators might kill lions, specifically baby lions. Hyena, I apologize, got quite excited. Leopard, if they find baby lions in a den, hyena, cheetah, jackal, python will kill lions. But once they're adults, generally most lions are either killed by hunting, and especially dangerous animals like buffalo, or they are killed by other lions. Very, very seldom that, in some cases hyenas as well, especially when if a female gets very, very old and emancipated, then sometimes hyenas will kill the females. So we're just going to scoot out to the open area, about 30 seconds, see if there's any ostriches. If there are no ostriches or big cats, we'll go back to Jamie and her big cats. Okay, ostrich, ostrich, ostrich. Are we going to see any ostrich? Not seeing any ostrich. Not seeing any cheetah just yet. Not seeing any male lions just yet either. Oh dear. Now, William's asking, what is a group of ostrich called? I think it's called a flock, William. A flock of ostrich. But unfortunately, apparently it's called a pride of ostrich, or a wobble of ostrich. I haven't heard those before. Now, the reason it might be called a pride is because an ostrich's call is sometimes confused for a lion roaring. But as you can see, we're going to have a quick sweep. You can see that they've had a bit more rain down here, that big storm that missed Juma. Touched on this part of the world, so you can see it's a bit more green, but unfortunately, as you can see, devoid of life at the moment. Well, not completely, I'm sure there's lots of living things there, we just can't see them. So nothing out here, so we're going to keep checking while we do that. Let's go back to Jamie and the Inkahuma pride.
We are so incredibly fortunate because we've actually just chatting to the various vehicles. Ephraim's on his way, but we are able to stay with these little cubs for as long as we want to on this beautiful bright winter's morning. Oh, you are cheeky. That was a brave decision. Amber Eyes is... That is so magic. That was absolutely wonderful. Amber Eyes just gave that cub an enormous hug. Such an enormous hug, actually, that it was kind of like everybody's boisterous aunt that squeezes and hugs a little bit too hard, and the cub has managed to make an escape now. I thought she was going to snarl at him for waking her up. That was awesome. I hope you got some amazing screenshots of that, because that wasn't even a hug from Mom. That was just a hug from Auntie Amber Eyes. And that name is now going to stick. It's Auntie Amber Eyes from now on. How loving was that? It's incredible. Just because it really, really does go to show how tightly bonded the these lions, as social cats truly are, and that, of course, is their key to their success. Say, Mum, did Aunt squeeze you a bit hard there? I hope you all got some amazing screenshots of that, because that was truly special. It really, really was. It made me wish for a camera. Lion hug. And that dichotomy between what we've seen with the Nkuhumas in terms of their fierce, awesome predatory skills, and then that gentle, loving side that comes out with each other and with their little ones. It's one of my favorite things about lions, is their social bonds, their social structure. Oh, Mommy, come on. Make some room. Budge up, everybody. I'm thirsty now. Coming in for a drink. Okay. One thing we are going to try and do is reposition and get to the other side of the lions. Just have a slightly different view. I'm just waiting for one of the other vehicles to move out so that we can move in. And what we do for new viewers with sensitive sightings like this, and this is sensitive just because of the age of the cubs, they're perfectly relaxed around us, as you can see. They're behaving as they would normally. But what we do when there are tiny little lion cubs is we restrict the number of vehicles that can come in at one time. So generally, we put three vehicles at one time in a sighting. That's the standard approach. And obviously we don't want to make it more than that, because it A, impacts the animal, and B, impacts the guest's experience in terms of seeing the animal. Then it turns into a sort of a manic system where you've got vehicles all over the place. And those of you who've been to Kruger, as special as Kruger is, you kind of know what it's like when there's a big cat sighting. It turns into a game of rush hour to try and maneuver your vehicle in and out. So that's not something that is allowed to happen here, for which we are incredibly grateful. But that's why we are constantly in communication on the Game Drive channel, to talk to the other vehicles, to let them know what our plans are, and also to just manage how many vehicles come in. And if, for example, I had come in and the cub was upset or nervous or scared in some way, copy. I'll keep an eye out. Maybe he's lying in the shade somewhere. Now, apparently, I've just heard from Aubrey that he thinks there is a male somewhere close by. That's why our lioness has been looking off in the direction that she has been. Guys, we're going to reposition, find ourselves a slightly nicer view. In the meantime, Brent is with my favorite animal name of all time, the wildebeest that he has named Gnorman. I'm not even going to try. Gnormless, there we go. Thank you, Brian. There we go. We're going over to Gnormless, whatever it is. We're going over to the wildebeest.
Well, there we go. Gnormless, Gnorman, the Gnu. The dominant male wildebeest on the southern plains. Let's just move a bit forward. And he looks like he's been having a jolly good time rolling around in the wet earth. And you can see he's got mud all over him. And he is probably quite ecstatic, about as ecstatic as Gnorman can be without having ladies in his vicinity, because he is feasting on the fresh green shoots that this rain has caused. Now, if we watch how wildebeests feed, they're very picky. Now, he'll go only for certain species, and wildebeest really, really prefer short grass. So Gnorman is in his element. The only way he could be more in his element is if he had some ladies around. But of course, Gnorman's mating season is over. The rutting season is over for the wildebeest. Now, wildebeest are one of our seasonal breeders out here, like Impala and Warthog. So we can be expecting baby Gnormans come November. Now, of course, his arch nemesis, Normal Norman, who lives down to the north of us, around the Cheetah Plains Pan, is around as well. So these big open plains are only inhabited by the strongest and most beautiful of the wildebeest, as it is ideal wildebeest habitat, these short grass plains. And so, which means Gnorman is a stud. And he's a good old mate of mine. I haven't seen him in a while. He's been being a bit scarce, but that's probably because there hasn't been too much grass about. He's had to meander his open plains quite extensively to get enough sustenance and have the odd altercation with Normal Norman when he goes to have a drink at the Cheetah Plains Pan. Now, fortunately for Gnorman, there's water on the plains, there's green grass, and fortunately for him, no lions. And speaking of lions, let's go back to Jamie.
We were about to reposition when the lions repositioned for us. The female got up with cubs still hanging from her, attempting to feed and squalling. And she's moved into a better patch of shade. Oh, little one. Hello. Okay. It's very, very hard to witness something that young and innocent struggling with an injury like that. But Mommy's still producing milk, and Mommy will make sure that it is safely transported to and from the kill sites that she will take them to. So as I said, definitely not a death sentence. At a very good point from Rhetus Fox, and it's a difficult question to answer, so Rhetus Fox would like to know how we recover from the tragedies that the wild does have. And of course we get to see the most amazing things, and at the same time sometimes things are very painful to watch, from the buffalo calf that we saw the other day struggling to get up, to the story of Kutile, although that wasn't something we had to witness, and her snake bite, the leopard with the snake bite. And now this little injured cub. And the question is, how do we recover? Is it not mentally draining? Yes, it is. And little, you know, each little heartbreak is there and constant. But you do get wrong way of phrasing it. If you didn't get used to it, though, you would be constantly brokenhearted out here. What hurts me, well, the way that I can, not justify it, but the way that I deal with it in my own mind, is to remember that this is the way of things for as long as these animals have existed. It's when it's a man-induced injury that it really, truly upsets me. When it's a situation where an animal's been poached or snared, or that is where I truly struggle. And it does take somebody a long time to recover from the emotional wounds that seeing something like that inflicts. But seeing the natural order of things, you can't just take the good out of it. You have to be able to, if you want to be able to enjoy what's happening out here, you kind of have to be able to lump the bad as well. But I mean, Brian, you said you were watching that buffalo kill the other day, and it was incredibly difficult to witness. It was for us as well. But the thing is, in the heat of the moment, you don't realize it, and it's only when you get home and you're shaking and you've got the buffalo bellows in your ears that you realize what it is that you've witnessed. I can't give you an easy answer to that question. I think you do get used to it in a way, and you have to sort of harden your heart a little bit. But that doesn't mean that it doesn't hurt. And watching a cub like this limp around is really, truly horrible to witness. If it were a leopard cub, it would be very, very concerning. But the fact that it's a lion cub, it's a lot more positive. Oh, little big yawn. Such a tired baby. No, it can still do some yoga. Stretch it out, baby. peaceful, beautiful family scene. What makes me very happy about this, it's sort of connected to the question I've just answered. What makes me happy about sightings like this is I think we've become so emotionally invested, particularly for me, because I didn't spend that much time with the Styx cubs before, or the Styx pride. They spent a lot of time south. But especially for me, I feel very emotionally invested in the Nkuhumas. Spent so much time with them, watching them go through the Birmingham Boyer takeover. They're brokers for peace when they were trying to mate with them, even though they knew that the Birminghams were still aggressive. So seeing these little cubs is a triumph. Right, it seems as though Cheetah Plains is bringing the jackal luck. Let's go back across to Brent and see which jackal he's got this time.
We have another side-striped jackal, but it's eating something, so I don't want to get too close. I wonder if it's found a plover nest. Oh, whatever it's eating, it's over. I think it has. Look at that, the blacksmith lapwing. Oh, maybe not. Yes, I think it ate a plover nest. Oh, it's getting mauled. Attack! Crown lapwings. Oh, there's a second jackal, but we can't see it just yet. Just sitting in the shade. There we go. Oh, is there three? No, it's a plover there. There we go. A second pair of side-striped jackal. This is a fair distance from where we saw the first two this morning. Such cool little creatures. Time to rest. Well, it seems the canids are out today. Hopefully we'll see the other two canids we get here, which is of course another jackal species, the black-backed jackal, and my favorite, the African wild dog. And no sign of normal Norman on this open area. Yeah, well, we're going to keep checking through Cheetah Plains, see if we can add another canid or two to our canid list for the morning. I actually didn't even mind seeing more side-striped jackal, to be honest. Other than the jackals, Cheetah Plains is a bit quiet this morning. Okay, let's continue on. Cheetah Plains pan. Warming up, but there's a cold wind this morning. So, as you say, I said, Cheetah Plains seems to have had a bit more rain than we have at Juma. We've only had one storm, they've had two. Bill's wondering, are the rains going to start coming? Well, traditionally, our rainy season begins in November. So, end of October, beginning of November. But we are in a drought, so it's going to be very interesting to see what happens with the rains this year. There's a possibility of La Nina, which is the opposite of El Nino, which means we're going to get an exorbitant amount of rain come September. But I'm not 100% convinced yet. And to quote Ernest Hemingway, there's two things one should never predict: the weather and a woman's moods. I'm already in trouble. Final control, ha 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 ha, very funny. Yes. Hopefully my mom didn't hear me saying that as well. Otherwise I'll be in more trouble. Fortunately, I think my mom's on game drive of her own, so I might get away with it. So while we keep seeing what other wonders Cheetah Plains can produce, let's go back to the Nkuhumas with Jamie.
We haven't had to wander too far afield to see the wonders that Juma has produced for us, or at least the Nkuhumas have produced for us. And I'm very happy that this was Brian's first drive back, getting to see the lion cubs that you'd seen them properly before you left. Yes, you did. Yeah. I remember now. So to be able to share this with Brian and see how much they've grown and so on is truly special. And the milk bar is currently open for business, and all three of them have found their spot, not without a bit of fussing, snarling at each other. And cubs have to fight over access to nipples, just in the same way that lionesses fight over access to the carcass. They kind of push and kick, and there's a lot of pulling and shoving, and just watch the poor mom lying there indulgently as those sharp little cub claws get dug into her fur. Can you just imagine what those sharp teeth are like? Like little needles. Those of you with puppies and kittens will know. Those baby teeth are more ferocious than anything the adults produce. Because it's like somebody... They're like needles. Picture of absolute contentment. This will never get old. Okay. Now that Ephraim has moved off, perhaps we should try and figure out a way to reposition, change our view ever so slightly, and at the same time have a look for this male that Aubrey is convinced is somewhere here. Let's just go. I think I see a relatively clear path to the lion, to a better view of the lions. Amber Eyes, in the meantime, is giving her paws a thorough cleaning. Let's not forget about her. Just because we've got some lovely lion cubs. Now, Amber Eyes, to us, I think she's my favourite lioness, maybe. I don't know, I can't choose. Lovely to hear from you, John, in Boston. While we reposition, let's answer John's question and try and multitask a little bit here. John, it is absolutely possible for a coalition's territory to encompass more than one pride. However, that doesn't mean that the prides will join together. So essentially, I'm just going to watch the animals' behavior very carefully as we do this. Cubs haven't even moved. So essentially, John, it's almost invariably the case that a male coalition, will actually encompass the territory of several females. So the Birmingham boys have the Styx pride and the Nkuhumas as their main two females. This is a dead tree, so that can go. Here we go. Hi, guys. Do you mind if we come and say hello? However, they remain distinct entities from each other. So the Styx pride will never join with the Nkuhumas. Me and my bright ideas, Brian. Is that okay? Perfect. However, different prides in an area can often be related to each other and sometimes rejoin. But that's only where they've split in recent, in sort of living memory of those particular members of that pride. So what I mean by that is, for example, the famous mountain pride, it had a couple of different names, but the famous mountain pride around the Lubombo Mountains of the Kruger National Park, they were 40 strong at one point, but what often happens in that situation is the pride splits off into different groups, because can you imagine how much food 40 lions needs? So whilst occasionally there were sightings of all of them together, and the Nkumas haven't quite got to 40 just yet, they're well on their way though, I mean they've doubled their number in the last few months. What would often happen is the pride would split off into little segments and then come back together every now and again. But that's quite a unique situation, and it only really occurs if there's been some kind of transitional happenings in the lives of the lions, so a pride takeover, or where the pride has got too big and there's lots and lots of lions. But generally, the male's territory encompasses several females, and whilst their cubs may be related to each other, because they'll share a father, the females will never be at peace with each other, and they generally avoid each other. The Styks and the Inkahumas, as neighbours, have had one or two run-ins. Most recent one was a couple of months ago before we had cubs coming out of our ears, so to speak, where the Styks got a little bit of a fright from the Inkahuma ladies. They were just outnumbered, and they were chased away. Steph phrased it beautifully. A lion pride, the females of a lion pride are the guardians of that genetic line. So the Inkahumas, for all we know, might have existed hundreds of years ago, generations ago. We're just fortunate enough. And prides come and go. They are successful at times, and then they become incredibly like the Shimungwes. The Shimungwe pride is now down to 3 sub-adults, and they haven't actually been seen in a very long time. They're around, though. They are definitely around, but the Shimungwe pride apparently was a very, very successful lion pride at one point, with lots of lions in it, and through various misfortunes are now, in the last lioness I think was killed by other lions, and now they're down to 3 young sub-adults who've been surviving basically off scavenging. And welcome back to Charlotte from Port Elizabeth. Hope you're enjoying your sunrise safari. And Charlotte, of course, being a South African, just like us. And Charlotte's question is about the genetics of a coalition and whether some of them are better than others. And yes, invariably they are. So there will be males that are bigger, stronger. They're generally the dominant ones. But look at the Matimbas and look at the Birmingham boys, in my mind. The Matimbas, look, I know the Birmingham boys are much younger, but the Matimbas are naturally bigger. They're taller lions. They're bigger, bulkier lions. Whereas the Birmingham boys are quite small, but they've got attitude. They've definitely got attitude, and they've got numbers on their side. So there will be certain genetic benefits to some coalition over others, but generally the best coalitions will dominate and pass on their genetic code. But it's also, again, it's a matter of circumstance. So Junior, with his Inkahuma-Matimba combination genetics, Junior was the young male that used to be with the Inkahuma pride. He has since dispersed, as young male lions do, and moved off. Junior, if he'd had brothers, he would have formed a coalition and he would have been a force to be reckoned with. That's not to say that he won't form a coalition and be a force to be reckoned with, but it's just taking him a little bit longer. And his chances are much more... or a lot slimmer, because he's all on his own. But he did have a marvellous genetic line. Junior was a very good-looking male, and he was big. He's bigger than the Birmingham boys when he was a year younger than them. Not heavier, but bigger, taller. Now, there will be certain genetic advantages in the same way there are with females. To me, the Inkahumas are more robust-looking lions than the Styks. The Styks, but that's not the Styks' fault. It might not even be a genetic thing. The Styks are struggling with skin diseases. We've seen with their cubs. Their cubs have got some serious mange on their skin and around their ears, scabby little ears. And the Styks also give evidence that they've got or are carrying tuberculosis, which is something we haven't seen from the Inkahumas. Doesn't mean they aren't. A lot of the lions in this area carry TB. But there are certain genetic advantages. I will tell you that the Inkahumas are probably some of the best-looking lionesses I've ever seen. But maybe I'm biased now. And they have produced some lovely-looking cubs. Oh, I think these cubs have all gone to sleep. They're not even actively suckling. Look at their breathing. They've all gone to sleep. Cute. Here comes Amber Eyes. She might shake things up a little bit. Oh. Stops to listen to something. And now she's going to go flop down in the shade. Personal space is not a huge issue in a lion pride. That was so cute. Cat? Some grumbling from the little cubs. Sorry, Cat. Cat's wondering about the red above the where the cubs are nursing. It's not a flower, Cat. It's dead leaves. They've taken on a very red color because of the sort of the autumnal effect, and because the light is shining through, it makes it look like a beautiful, bright, fire red flower. Now, whilst we do have some lovely flowers out here, that is not one of them. It's just some dried leaves. It looks like it's bush willow, probably variable bush willow, just by the size of the leaves. Variable or large fruited bush willow. And the sun is shining through them, making them glow a beautiful red color. But it is not a flower, unfortunately. Not much is flowering right now, except I think Brent actually did tell you our Impala lily is attempting to. It's trying very hard to get its flowers out, which we're very excited about. And the narrow-leaved calanchoe is also flowering. But soon we will be getting a whole host of flowers, and one of them will be the bright red star zinnias that we get. Another reason to keep watching. You know, if you needed any more encouragement in watching lion cubs suckle and then being squished by their aunt. I'm quite comfy there, using the cubs as a pillow. It really does give you a sense of scale when you see things like this. Now, those cubs are basically the size of Amber Eyes' head, and they probably weigh about as much. Ha ha! It is, I said earlier, there are cubs coming out of our ears. Let us go all the way over to Cheetah Plains to talk or to have a look at some lions we've been talking about.
Look at this! They've come back onto Cheetah Plains. Isn't this exciting? All eight cubs running around. Oh, I'm going to move the vehicle to get up ahead of them. Isn't this absolutely exquisite? It's something about little lion cubs that does make me go a little bit silly. They're just the bestest monster. Why are you charging it directly at us? That's definitely a boy. Oh, isn't this magnificent? Michael, if the sticks and all of my twins are heading towards the nets across the open area in front of your car. Oh, listen to that. Ow! Ow! Isn't this just too special? You can hear them. Ow! Oh, it looks like they're going to lie down. Let's get into the spot. Oh, jump on one! Look at this. So this is a very typical little lion behavior. He's watching the wheels go around. He's excited. Definitely.
Oh, dearie me, it seems as though the gremlin, what was it, Gremlin Hollow, is exactly where the sticks have decided to go. But what a marvellous morning spent with our lions. Cubs everywhere, sort of. I don't know where the rest of the Unkahuma cubs are. They're a little bit younger than the sticks cubs, so they're not all together. They're still kept separate. So whilst the older two sets, this group of three and then the group of two, are coming together at kills, they're still being stashed away. That makes them sound like groceries, but they're being stashed away separately whenever their mothers go out hunting. The youngest set, we know where they are. Herbert did find the den site, but it's impossible for us to get into there without doing some serious environmental damage. So we've decided to just let them be, and we'll wait for them to come out when they are good and ready and old enough. And now we've got a puddle of lions. Now, depending upon what happens with Brent and those Styx cubs, I suppose we should think about moving off and looking for other things. I know I'm a bit reluctant to. I'm quite happy where we are. I'm convinced there's a male somewhere. He's probably watched me reposition and drive around him. What is that? No, that's a leaf. Just checking in the dense vegetation. It's a very tricky block. But the way that she was intently looking off into the distance makes me think that either the rest of the pride is somewhere here, or the males are around. At least one male is around. Now they alternate. They spend their times with they spend their times between the Nkuhumas and the Styx, and then marking their territory. One thing we have noticed, it feels as though the Birmingham boys have spent a lot more time north. That might be due to the fact that there's two dead elephants up there, so free meal. Essentially, free, enormous meal. It's like an all-you-can-eat buffet. Oh, hello. Somebody's awake, looking for a bit of attention. Oh. Mom is a milk bar and a jungle gym, all rolled into one. Aww. So gentle. I mean, her paw is the size of that cub's head. And now, after a big feed, it is nap time for the little round-bellied cubs. Finding a comfortable spot. So cute with their round bellies, and feet in the air. A really comfortable spot. Oh, it seems as though Brent has found a signal patch. Let's head across to him.
So it's not the greatest signal, and we can't really move, but we've still got these wonderful little cubs. And some of them are actually even climbing trees off to the right. So you can see that, isn't that wonderful? A little bit more to the right there, Thunder. There we go. Pretending to be a leopard. Now, lions, when they're cubs, it is quite common for the little guys to play on fallen trees like that. Unfortunately, I'd love to move a bit closer, but there's a cub in my way in the road. Nice problem to have. Oh, look at that. They're all over there. Having a grand old time. Mic fell off, there we go, it should be better now.
Oh dearie me, Gremlin Hollow is playing havoc with Brent's signal. Luckily for all of us, we've got cubs on one side and the other of this reserve. So we are still with our puddle of lion cubs. all curled up together, fast asleep. A truly peaceful family scene. However, I do think I'm just going to give it a little bit longer to see where the sticks go and whether or not Brent will have signal. Otherwise, we'll probably move off from our lines and go and see what else we can find. Perhaps there's more of them around Buffelzoek Dam. And then, of course, there's an update, by the way, on Tingana. I forgot to tell you all. I'm sorry. Now, yesterday, Tingana was seen around Juma. He has since moved east into Torchwood. Tingana is the dominant male leopard of this area. So he is on Torchwood right now. Just for an update for those of you who've been keeping track of his movements. It's very nice to have him back once again. We seem to go through extended periods of his absence before he reappears. Let's go back to Brent's lion cubs and see what antics they're up to now.
So there's actually now 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of them up on that little tree. They're being very, very cute. Now, unfortunately, they are in a terrible signal area for us. Oh, you can hear the squirrels alarming. Now the lionesses have gone off. I think they've spotted something on the other side. Oh no, there's one lioness still here, but they've definitely gone into more of a hunting mode. Come to the right, a little gap. Let me see if we can get it from where you are. It'll be come out of it.
They're just there.
There.
Yeah.
And it's a female and one of the cubs. You can hear a squirrel. Lion, 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 lion. As you can see, these cubs are not quite as good looking. Oh, Sander.
Sorry.
No problem. As the Inkahuma cubs. And they do look like they've got, I'm not sure if it's mange, but they do have some sort of skin irritant. And you can see this little one walking in front of us has got it quite badly. There we go, you should sit there. And Stephanie's wondering how it's passed along. Stephanie, it's passed along by from other lions to lions. I'm sorry, I'm just going to be on the Game Drive channel. Sinead, go ahead. They've just gone static. The females look like they might have seen something in a net, but they're still on the CP side. On that little two-track that runs down parallel to the Shkova from the pan in front of the Kaya. Okay, I'm just going to try and move a little bit. Those cubs on the tree are being awesome. I think you might be able to get a through there onto the tree. Look at that. Enjoying the warmth of the sun. I'm just going to grab a quick photo. I hope you guys are getting some awesome screenshots of this. I don't want to move too much because this is a really tricky area from a signal point of view. Let's see all of them out on that fallen down marula tree. Let's go to the one out on the right. Mm. Keep going. Mm. There we go. Okay, he's popped his head behind a branch for us. Oh, turnaround time. Oh, and back to studio. Okay. I'm just going to warn you, I'm going to try and move, so we might lose signal. But I just want to try and get into a better position to have a look at those cubs.
And back with our puddle of lions as Brent once again goes through the gremlin infested patch. So we do apologize for that. As you know, bringing you a live, or as you can imagine perhaps, bringing you a live safari from the middle of the African bush, I don't pretend to know how it works. It is far too complicated for me, but it does work. And every now and again things go wrong, but we're still here. We are still comfortably sitting. I'm actually really enjoying this spot. We've got some sun. Got Brian back so we can catch up on what he's been up to and leave and so on, fill him in on all of the details of what's been happening while he's been away, and of course with lions right next to our vehicle snoozing away quite happily. I did say I was going to leave, but I haven't. I can't quite bring myself to tear myself away from this. Within the Nkuhuma pride, we have got three mothers with the eight sets of cubs, or the eight cubs between them. Morning, Amber Eyes. And back to sleep. Kevin, that is the one thing that lions are very, very good at, and it's part of the key to their success, and might even have been one of the reasons why they evolved as a social cat. Because yes, their females will feed cubs that are not their own. They do what's known as allo-suckling. That basically means they will feed their own offspring and that of the other lionesses, because of course for them, the lionesses in their pride are related to them in some way, whether it is a daughter or a mom or a sister or a cousin. Either way, they are very, very closely connected in terms of genetics, so investing in the other's cubs makes total sense for them. We happen to enjoy a sighting with the Styx pride that Brent is with at the moment, where only one of the females is still lactating, the mother of the youngest set of cubs. This poor lioness was lying on her back with about five lion cubs of different ages and sizes, all attempting to suckle from her, growling at each other, clinging on her, fighting over access to milk, and she just lay there and tolerated it. But I did feel very sorry for her, because the last lioness to stop lactating is usually the one that has to deal with cubs of several different ages attempting to suckle. And like all baby mammals, lion cubs will push and push to be able to suckle for as long as possible. And they throw their own weaning tantrums. Not quite as dramatic as an elephant, but they do sort of make their angry growling sounds when they're no longer allowed to feed. And then life gets actually quite tough, because although lions are social cats and the bonds between them are tight, when it comes to mealtime, it's every lion for themselves, including for the cubs. And there's nothing to stop a lioness from swatting a cub away that's attempting to feed. And they kind of have to make do with the scraps. Although, we saw them barreling over that buffalo carcass the other day, having a wonderful time. Our cubs are fast asleep, but Brents are wide awake. Let's go and have a look at them learning to climb trees.
A little bit up to the left there, Thunder. The one walking, oh, nearly fell off. We've got to push from behind. Isn't this incredible? I think I've managed to find a spot that's got signal. Isn't that incredible? Isn't that lucky? So, hopefully, it stays that way. I hope you guys are getting some fantastic shots of this. They're just the sweetest. They're just too precious. Look, here we go, climbing. Isn't this special? And just watching them, they are just too precious. They're not the best looking bunch of cubs I've ever seen in my life, that's for sure. But, and they are very, very playful. Judy H says, this is what you call a lion log. I couldn't agree with you more. We got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of the cubs all on a single fallen marula. I'm just waiting for one to fall off, which I'm pretty sure is going to happen. And fortunately, we've managed to find a spot in this little river system that does have a signal. Oh, here we go. Here's trouble. Attack. Oh. It looks like there might be a fall off at on the left. Let's probably not call it a falling off, maybe an undignified descent. Oh, isn't that just too cute? Get them growling at each other. Well, thanks again for all the screenshots, guys. Remember, if you are screenshotting, share it with the hashtag Safari Live, or pop it on the Safari Live Facebook page or on any of the viewer Facebook groups. There are lots of them. Juma Junkies, Lions and Leopards of the Juma Cheetah Plains and Arethusa. I love that sound so much. Oh, there's a bit of a attack going on. No, just a descent. Oh, here we go. Oh, isn't that just too special? Now, how do you get past your cousin or sibling? Cousin, I think, just judging from the size. Oh, you just sneak past. That's very polite. I thought you were going to push her off. It's so wonderful to have this many cubs about at the moment. Cubby. Wrong way. Cubby, thanks, Sinead. Cat's wondering, do lion cubs right themselves during a fall, always landing on their feet? Not so much, Cat. They're not quite as skillful as a house cat yet. So I have seen them take some interesting tumbles. Bow, bow. Complaining. What are you complaining about? Oh, wonderful. Oh, come to the left. Oh no, there's a bug. Oh, there's so much going on. Let's getting a bite on the bottom. Michaela in Johannesburg says, well, lions seem more like dogs than cats with their social skills. Now, they are indeed the only social, truly social cat in the world. But they are definitely cats. And even in their behavior, it is very cat-like, but as I said, very different with the social aspect. But that social aspect enabled them to outcompete giant hyenas, saber-toothed cats, and become the dominant predator. So those saber-toothed cats and giant hyenas were obviously much bigger than lions, but by being social, they were able to outcompete them. Oh, shame! Being manhandled. That's a young boy who's doing the biting there. On one of the younger cubs. All four at the end, the fifth has moved off. Decided the log's getting a bit busy. Oh. At least it wasn't too high. That was a purposeful descent. This is just too special. Remember, if you want to know anything about these little lions, hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or pop us an email, questions@wildearth.tv. I just had to jump on the game drive for a second. Mike, did you copy that update about Sticks and Montoine on you and all? Affirm, Mike, there's the two track that runs parallel to the drainage line that's from your kaya. They're on that two track. Negative, they've gone flat on CP. Sorry about that, just making sure that Mike knows that there are lions in front of his lodge. They're probably about 150 meters away from the closest guest room at Cheetah Plains, and while everyone was in game drive, they were drinking in front of the main area. Oh, they're just so special. Trud is wondering, why do the cubs keep licking the tree? Because they can. They're also just chewing the bark and just being generally quite playful, as young creatures tend to be. Oh, here we go. Let's see what you... Are you going to go play King of the Castle? No. Didn't quite make it all the way up. Oh, here we go. Dun, 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 dun. Oh, no, just coming for a cuddle. Not a fight, just a cuddle. I think with their skin irritation, these cubs quite like the roughness of the bark. You can see how they sort of rub their bellies on it. And I said, I'm not sure, it could be mange, but there's quite a few different types of mange. mangers caused by mites. It could also be fungal. And it seems that with the adults seem to go through it from time to time, but they seem to recover. It does seem to get better. Hopefully these little guys start looking a bit prettier soon. And it's so amazing. And if you compare them to the Nkuhuma pride, and the cubs there are so fluffy and perfect. Although I must admit, these lot seem to have lots of character. So Gregory is wondering about these skin issues, and he says, will it eventually remedy itself, or will they have it forever? Well, with the Birminghams and this adult sticks, it seems to remedy itself for a while, then it gets bad again. So it's very difficult to actually tell, because I can see the lionesses have it on their belly as well. But it's not as apparent as it is in the cubs. Oh, it looks like they might get on the move again. One lioness might be just going to join the other lioness in the shade. Oh, I think that's what she's doing. Now, I don't want to move the vehicle at the moment, as we might lose a signal, but so we're just going to sit here. We say, look at that, come on, look at that. Now, that is what you call draped over a branch. That little boy, he's the same one who came charging towards our car earlier when he saw our tires turning. He's quite big compared to the rest of the cubs. Oh. Well, some of the cubs look like they're going to start suckling. We're going to stick with the last tree dweller. Now, how is that comfortable, Mr.? Yes, I can't imagine that could have been comfortable for too long. And I don't know if you're picking up that sound behind us. The rest of them are suckling. And I wonder if the last tree dweller, the sound of feeding cousins and siblings will attract them towards the females. Okay. I don't want to move just because it's such a precarious signal area. So if there is an aerial whatnot in the way, we do apologize, but just to show you what's going on back there, it's literally a scrum down of little cubs trying to all feed off the one lioness. So there are only two or three cubs not there. Yeah, Mike, make your way straight in, it's just me. Those noises are incredible. It's just a pile of little lions trying to feed. Wow, very upset. David's wondering, do lions purr? They don't, David. They can growl and roar and snarl, but not so much of the purring. A clickety click is just me getting a few snaps. Let's have a look back at the tree climber. He's up to mischief, or he's just actually looking, posing very regally on top. Oh, now he's not. Now he's flopped over again. And he was posing very regally. I mean, hopefully he'll do it again. Oh, there we go. That's a bit better. He seems far more interested in us than joining in the massive... the cubs all trying to feed at the same time. He goes from looking very, very regal to very, very sloppy. So Kevin's wondering how many cubs can suckle at one time. Only as many cubs as a lioness has teats, and she's got... I've gone completely back. So four, sorry. They're about four at a time. That's why it's very unusual to have more than four cubs. Oh, it looks like another cub is coming to play on the tree. Coming in from underneath. Another one of the older cubs. Oops-a-daisy. They all seem to like that little... branch there, little piece of marula bark, good fun to play with. Mike, do you have my visual? Oh, there we go, doing a bit of defleeing. Lioness is up again. So the cubs, she got tired of the cubs feeding and she's walking away. So they just moved on to the next lioness, but some of the cubs are following her now. There we go. She's now blocked our way out. Isn't that just too cute? Ooh, getting upset. Sorry about my laughing, it's just too much. On a few short months there, their voice is going to change, and when they snarl like that, it's going to be quite scary. At the moment, it just sounds quite funny. Oh, it seems like the status quo has been reached for now. This is very, very special to be able to spend the amount of time we do with these incredible animals. So I'm very nervous to move. I might try in a little bit, just so we can try to get a better position on the feeding. Trying to think where we might still have signal. I'm planning my next move so we can try to get a bit closer to that. I think I'm a mass of lions, a pile of lions. Oh, here we go. Here comes some growling again, I'm sure. Trying to sneak in there. Little ears flat. Okay. So, I'm going to try to get us into a better spot for that, so we might... Oh no, just quickly before we go, let's go back to the tree. Look at this. Oh, being pushed off. Oh. No, back on. That's a wonderful thing about these guys when they are playful. They are very playful. So, we're going to try to get us a better position of that scrum of lions feasting off mother's milk while we do that. Let's go back to Jamie and her lion cubs.
I'm sorry. I'm laughing. That was hilarious. That was absolutely incredible. I'm so sorry that you missed it. It was just by a split second, and it was so unexpected. Basically, the one cub climbed on top of the other cub and was trying to wake it up. And the other little cub was kind of snarling and growling, but not really objecting too much. But then, all of a sudden, lost its temper and turned around and snapped at the lion cub on top. And the lion cub on top got such a fright that it levitated backwards and fell over. This is why lion cubs are so thoroughly entertaining. Did not want to be disturbed. The one at the back is full of energy and wants to play with something. And everybody's being so boring. Perhaps I'm going to come and see what these human beings are doing. What are you? Can I play with you? Wake up! Lesson not learned. Okay, fine. I'll just lick your ear. Lick and nibble on your ear until you have to wake up. Oh! Beware. Flopping lions everywhere. This poor cub on the bottom. Not having the easiest time of things. All it wants to do is sleep. Luckily, lions are expert sleepers. I'm going to chew you until you get up. Look how big their feet are already. Now battering mom at the same time. Little mischief. They've got these enormously oversized paws. A bit of shuffling around going on. Poor cub's trying to find a comfortable spot to go to sleep. Oh, might be awake now. The lure of a foot just proves to be irresistible. It's so feline, these actions. Lazy playing. Lazy horizontal playing. I think there's two males in this group, and I think these are two males. I haven't had a chance to properly check. There's definitely one male in this triplet. I think there might be two. And the smallest one is nestled in between Amber Eyes and the mother. Oh, you are just causing trouble. You are a troublemaker. You're bored and you want somebody to entertain you. Like a child, like a toddler. Or indeed like quite a few adults, I know. Playing with fire again. I wouldn't chew on Auntie Amber Eyes' ear. She doesn't take too much nonsense, although the last time I said that, she just turned around and gave it a bear hug, or a lion hug. Lion cubs are very seldom flat for long, unless they have enormously full bellies. They're usually occupied doing something, with the most incredible sighting with the Styx cubs in Juma Dam recently. With them barreling about, we didn't know where to look. Couldn't decide which set of cubs to watch. And that's going to be the case with the Nkuhumas as well, once we get all eight together. Must be so nice. Got a constant playmates around them. Even when the adults are being boring. Look how comfortable her crossed feet look, resting casually on poor Amber's. Obviously, as you can tell, my threats of leaving have been seriously not followed through. I just couldn't bring myself to tear us away from the sight that we've been witnessing. Just in case we come back this afternoon and they've vanished. Which hopefully they won't have. Hopefully we'll have an afternoon to look forward to spending with them as well. And as I said, already empty bellies, or relatively empty bellies for the Nkuhuma girls. They're going to have to think about going to find some more food. Hopefully this time they will be able to eat it straight away instead of having to wait for the Birmingham boys to eat their fill. Very comfortable looking. And just this little cub is up to nonsense at the back there, but we just can't see what it's doing. Every now and again a paw flashes up, or the ears flash up behind Amber Eyes. Hints of movement. Ah, there you are. We see you now. What are you doing? Trying its luck with every lion. Get a playmate. It's not working out so well. Amber Eyes is not even paying any attention. You're going to get a smack, little one, if you're not careful. It's amazing how tolerant the lionesses truly are. She hasn't even opened her mouth and nipped his foot yet. Ooh, claws have come out. Just saw a hint of them peeping through. And just because it's a cub doesn't mean those claws are not razor sharp. In fact, they're even sharper than an adult's, like its teeth. Digging them underneath Amber Eyes' chin. It's lucky lions are so good at sleeping. No wonder they get so good at sleeping. It's getting hard to tell which lion is which now. Oh, no, that didn't work. Amber Eyes didn't work. I'm going to try and climb onto Mom. Oh, there's Amber Eyes' leg. Anything's a game. You are a little nonsense. This is definitely the lion cub with plenty of character. I'm sure it's a male. Maybe a bit more breakfast might be the way forward. Oh. They must feel so safe in there. Two giant lionesses on either side of you. Doesn't get safer than that. The perfect spot. Still wants to play with Amber Eyes' paw, and she's just not cooperating. And of course, all of this is basically preparing them for a time when they will be fierce hunters, famed for their skill in terms of taking down big game like buffalo. Now it's play, but it's very, very important play. And the bonding that they do is also essential because it's what makes a lion pride such an unstoppable team. Oh, Mom's had it. All she wants to do is go and lie down in the shade and not be harassed. Some very disgruntled cubs, but Mom has had it. Good try, little one. Not quite, but good try. And now that Mom has managed to find a comfortable spot, immediately there's not a second's peace for our lioness mothers, immediately being annoyed by one of her babies. And Virginia, it is possible. So what Virginia's asked is whether or not when it comes time for the young males of this particular group of cubs to leave the safety of the pride at around 2.5, 3, when they are sub-adults, let's say closer to 3, Virginia wants to know whether the male, the Nkuhumas and the Sticks would join up. Possibly. It depends very much on what kind of ratio we've got here. Now, I haven't had a chance to properly look at the dynamics of the Sticks, but I actually think that there's quite a few males in that group. So if there's quite a few males in the Sticks and quite a few males in the Nkuhumas, then they probably won't join up. They will stay with the cubs that they've grown up with and are closely related to. However, let's say that this little chap, who's has been causing all the nonsense, oh, shame, baby. Still feeding. Still full of spirit. But let's say this is the only little male in the Nkuhuma group of cubs. It's unlikely. I don't think it's the case, but let's say it was. And it had to go off on its own and it happened to encounter some young Sticks males of a similar age, then absolutely they would join up. So male lions are, unlike the females that are very strictly related to each other, the males are not so fussy because they can't afford to be. The advantage of numbers trumps anything else. So forming a coalition with an unrelated male is very common. Leave that little one alone. Here we go. Nope. No suckling allowed. They make surprisingly deep growls for such little creatures. Very fierce sounding. We're going to leave our lionesses now, I think, and start wending our way home, see what else we can find for the last few moments of the sunrise safari. Let's go back across to Brent, who has made his way out of Cheetah Plains.
Well, sorry about that. As we went live, a leaf flew right into the lens. Off you go, be free, leaf. Wow, wasn't that amazing? So exciting. Cubs, and more cubs. I think we're going to have to find a new collective noun for cubs. There's just so many of them about at the moment. And unfortunately, they moved a little bit, not far, but about 10 meters deeper into that little river system. And we were right at the edge of our signal range as it was. So, but what an incredible incredibly wonderful sighting of the Styx Pride. Now I wonder where all the Birminghams are, but wonderful. So we were looking for canines and we got cats. I'm not going to complain. And again, thanks to for all the questions that came through. And a big welcome a few new viewers. And what a morning to start on. Lion cubs everywhere. And I've just heard that there's some incredible screenshots. I've got some competition out there. You guys with your screenshots getting better shots than I can get with my camera. But that, yeah, I'm still on such a high. It was such an incredible little, incredible sighting of those little guys. Oh, the wind is now picked up. So even though it's sunny and bright, there's this, well, it's a stiff breeze, but when you're driving and it's a bit chilly, it feels a lot stronger. And it's going to be very interesting to see what those sticks do on the sunset safari. I've got a feeling they might unfortunately pop across that little drainage line. That is our western boundary on Cheetah Plains, and they might go across to her net. But of course, there's always the chance that Nkanyeni and her two cubs were heading down towards Cheetah Plains. So Nkanyeni is a female leopard, and she's got a male and female cub. If I remember correctly, probably about 8 or 9 months old at the moment. So exciting times. If we think about cubs, okay, we've got the Styx cubs, 8. We've got the Nkuma cubs, 8. We've got Nkanyeni, 2 cubs. We've got Karula, 2 cubs. We've got Shadow, 1 cub. And we've got Tandi, 2 cubs. Just cubs. Who's missing cubs? Who hasn't had cubs yet? Well, Shaluva, 2005, because she's been seen mating. Hi, Ian. Ian's in Johannesburg. He wants to know, will we be voting today? We will. We're registered in the local community and there is a vehicle going out so we can vote. So as soon as we've had breakfast, the team will be heading out towards Dixie to go vote. Oh, it is incredible. The only thing I'm a little bit sad about is that Karula has crossed to the south. Fingers crossed she is going to come back to the north. Tingana went into this property here to the right to meet Torchwood. No one's managed to find him this morning yet. So who knows, maybe he'll also make an appearance on the sunset safari. Now, young Sindile has been out and about. The last spot he was pinged off his collar was in Buffalo's Hook, not too far from the Juma boundary. So it might be worth also having a squiz around there. I really would love to see that pack of wild dogs again. And as I said, that pack of 3 wild dogs we've been seeing is not our normal pack. They are a dispersal pack from the lower Sabi pack. So I wonder what we're going to call these ones. Something we're going to have to think about, especially if they decide to hang around a bit longer. So that's the incredible thing about being in this open system. New creatures that can come from anywhere in the greater Kruger can arrive. Could get new lions, as we've got new wild dogs, new cheetah, even new leopards. I'm pretty sure Gajima, our ghost from the north, also came from there. So we are moving towards the end of our sunrise safari. And Zander and I are about to go through the Mulwanini, which is a famous gremlin habitat at the bottom of this little steep river. So we've had an absolutely splendid time with you, and we had some cats and dogs, jackals and lions, and what a great way to start. Now you said Ellie's and in Kahuna's with Jamie. Speaking of Jamie, let's send you back across to her for the final few minutes of drive while we go through gremlin country.
Guess what I've just seen, which is really, really exciting. Just in case we needed more evidence that spring is indeed on its way, I'm trying to find it again for you, but I think, whoopsie, I'm so busy looking into the air I nearly drove into a hole. Red-chested swallows are back. They're one of the first migratory bird species to return to our shores, and I've just seen 2 of them plucking mud up from the puddles to start building their nests. Now, I get really excited. Most We get really excited about that sort of thing. First of all, for those of you who've only jumped on board in the last few months, it means some new birds to add to your bird list, birds that you haven't seen. And for those of you who are regular viewers of the show, it's always nice. It's like marking the passing of time in a much more natural way than a calendar. The red-chested swallows are back once again. I'm just still trying to find it for you, but I think unfortunately it's flown away. You'll have to trust me, you'll have to take my word for it. But we'll start seeing them more and more regularly. I thought I saw one the other day, and then I told myself I was going crazy. But nope, they are most definitely back with us once again. And of course, some of the swallow species, you will actually, those of you who are living in Europe, in the UK, you will be familiar with the swallows that we get, that will, they haven't quite left yet, but the barn or the European swallows are on their way back as well at some point soon. Those will be birds that you get for half of the year and we get for the other half. So exciting stuff. Cubs everywhere, green grass sprouting through, birds returning, insect life returning. I've noticed a lot more noise at night. Summer is slowly on its way. Justin, just a quick answer for our last question of the day. Welcome on our sunrise safari. Justin wants to know how many years I've spent living in the bush. I spent a year before I went to university, so when I was still young. And then I've been in the Hoedspruit area for the last 4 years. 4.5 years now that I have been living in this particular area and absolutely loving it. And getting to go out and do this every day, twice a day, is an absolute pleasure. And of course we've all grown up, none of us have had a background quite like Brent's, but we've all grown up visiting the bush, going to the Kruger National Park. For us it's part of our background, it's part of who we are. We were chatting earlier on Facebook Live, Charlotte said there's a cold front on its way to us. Judging by the way that the wind is howling this morning, it's going to hit us, ow, stick to the face, it's going to hit us relatively soon. I think we could start looking south for banks of clouds that might be on their way. But that's good, might mean some rain, a little bit more green, more birds, more insects, it's all very, very exciting. And so, I think we are coming to the end of our sunrise safari, and it comes time for us to say goodbye to you all, the saddest part of our morning. So it is indeed time to say goodbye. A big thank you to Brian, as always, for his fantastic camera work, and a huge welcome back to both the Brian and the Thumb. That's a pleasure. It's the inseparable duo that's lovely to have back on board with us once again. For those of you who've only joined us in the last 2 weeks, the Thumb, you have to watch every single day because the Thumb never looks the same. The Thumb is always different and always entertaining. Sorry, I couldn't hear that. Donna said something about your thumb, Brian.
Sunflower seeds,
because poor Brian came back to a devastated sunflower garden after a bushbuck came in and ate them all. It was really sad. Sorry, Brian, that you came back to that. Okay, no, it really is time for us to say goodbye once again. But we will be back this afternoon for the Sunset Safari, so we look forward to seeing you then. Thank you to Kirsty and to Rebecca in Final Control, keeping us on our toes and keeping us in line. And most importantly, a big thank you to all of you joining us from across the world. I hope you have a wonderful day or evening, and that we will catch up with you this afternoon on the Sunset Safari. Bye-bye.